Welcome to A Celtic State of Mind. I'm Paul John Dykes, and tonight I'm joined by Declan McConville. Declan, welcome to the show.
Thanks for the invite, Paul.
It's always a privilege and a pleasure to have you on the show, Declan. It's certainly not your debut, but tonight, just before the European encounter against Reykjavik, which we'll be talking about later on, we're here to talk about your Celtic Supporters Club. So, you were a founder member of the club. When did it start up?
2018.
So prior to that, talk to me about your Celtic support in life leading up to the decision that you made to get involved in setting up your own supporters club.
Anybody that knows me will know I go to games with my dad and always have done. So a lot of the time going to Celtic Park, we just generally went in the car. From a young age, he went in a bus previous to kind of me being born, and then kind of fell away from it. It was just easier to take the car, more convenient. And then we joined another supporters club from the Winters Jills in Great Western Road. It's owned by Paul Shevlin, who's related to Chris Shevlin, used to play for Celtic for a short spell, and Hearts, and that's how we used to get to games. And then eventually we went back to the pub that my dad used to go on the bus from to games, previously on the Garski Ben Road, now the Maryhill Bertie Auld. So that's how we kind of... He went round in full circle back to where he'd kind of begun going to Celtic Park from Maryhill.
You talk about Chris Shevlin, yeah. I mean, Celtic won the European Cup, and the two signings that they made after winning the European Cup were Pat McMahon, yep, from junior football, and Chris Shevlin, who had actually retired from Hearts with a bad injury. And Jockstein managed to get a second opinion on him and brought him out of retirement. Now, Declan, can you imagine the Twitter furore after winning the European Cup? You've signed a croc and a junior player. Yeah. But interestingly enough, he is also related through the marriage of his son to Sean Farland.
Yes.
So talk to us about that a wee bit as well.
Yeah, I know a lot of Sean's grandchildren because they work in the pub and stuff, Aisling, young Michael. And I kind of became good friends with Sean Jr. as well, who's a cracking guy. So that's been nice too. Two big footballing families, the Shevlins and the Fallons, but they're all really nice folk, and it's been really nice getting to know them. I never actually met Sean. I know you did an interview with him in Winters Jills.
I did.
But from all accounts, really nice guy, and a complete Celtic legend.
That was a memorable day, Declan. Beautiful sunny day, and sitting outside on the Great Western Road. And he had a few wee nips that day. I think his wife Myra had gone for shopping with his daughter. And if I remember right, he liked a wee smoke, did Sean. He was smoking silk cut cigarettes. But, you know, just talking to that man, he was the final link to, you know, Jockstein's management side that conquered Europe. And there was a sadness because I remember at one point he said he misses his friends. That, you know, he misses Neely Mockin, he misses Jock and Jimmy Steele, Bob Rooney, and it was a bit sad, but funny man, and he kept me amused for a good couple of hours that day. It's unforgettable speaking to a man like Sean Farland, Declan, as you can imagine, but I echo your sentiments about Sean Jr., who's a smashing lad, as is Neely Mockin Jr. as well, both massive Celtic fans. So you've gone to the supporters club that ran out of the boozer. And how did that develop from there to you and some others saying, you know, let's set up our own club?
Gags, or Gary Love, as people know him, was good friends with Bertie Auld when Gary got married in Vegas and Bertie was his best man at a convention. Mm-hmm. So they kept a good relationship. Obviously, Bertie's just from up the road. So Gary took over the pub. That kind of became an issue that myself, my dad, my godfather, and our guy that goes to football, Dougie, left that bus, and we're kind of, what do we do now? And we saw that wee opportunity there, spoke to Gary, and we said, okay, go for this if you're happy for us to run a bus out the pub. Yep, definitely. And we phoned Bertie, told him we're going to name a bus after him, because for some reason, there's a couple of buses that run out of Maryhill, no one is called after Bertie. So we contacted Bertie, gave us a thumbs up, and it's just kind of taken off from there.
Well, we can't do an Axon meets the Bertie Auld CSC without talking about the man himself, Declan. Talk to us about your experiences with Bertie Auld.
Just a really lovely guy. Anybody that has the pleasure to meet the Lisbon Lions know how humble they are. And he is so, so lovely. He's just a great guy. Never saw him refuse a photograph or a chat with anybody. And it's just great to be from a place that a guy that conquered Europe with that famous Celtic team hails from. He's just brilliant. And he's still, you know, he's so active. His jokes are, sometimes you might have heard them before, but they're still good for a giggle. And he's still fit as a fiddle, you know, at the grand old age 82 he is now.
It's incredible when you start looking at the 80s now. I know that John Fallon turned 80 just the other day there, Declan, and, you know, they are, they're getting into that time of life, and it's, we should celebrate them at every opportunity, Declan, you know. As you say, Bertie, he is, you know, it's one of these things, people get called legends all the time, but Bertie Auld, when he walks in the room, you know that that's wee Bertie, because he, you know, he's got a certain aura about him, a certain confidence, and you could listen to him all night, couldn't you?
Yes, you could. And he said he came up to the pub last season, and it was a great line. He said, I can be invited anywhere in the world, but nothing beats coming home. And that was really nice, I think, for everybody in the pub that day to see that, you know, he's not forgot his roots. He still remembers his mother having a shop just up the road and where he grew up before he would obviously go on to become a professional footballer.
And he tells a great tale, you know, when he's talking about signing for Celtic, and, you know, he could have gone elsewhere for more money, but he bought into it because of Jimmy McGrory, didn't he?
Yeah.
He went and visited Celtic Park with his dad. And Jimmy McGrory deserves immense credit. We had a brilliant discussion with the guys from The Rock. Obviously, their stadium, their ground is called James McGrory Park. And they were talking about plans, Declan, to erect or start fundraising to erect a statue of Jimmy McGrory. How overdue is that?
It's massively overdue. There's been talk of, you know, Fergus McCann stands at Celtic Park, etc. But a man that's placed should be recognised at Celtic Park as Jimmy McGrory. I mean, the record speaks for itself, 550 goals. Obviously not just a player, but a manager. And going back in that, I mean, some of his achievements as manager, Coronation Cup, 7-1, nearly led Celtic to our first final, European final in 1963. Apart from a horrific, disastrous match against MTK Budapest, which John Fallon's told me about many a time. But yeah, massively overdue, and he should deserve his place there beside Billy, Jimmy, Brother Wilfred and Jock Steen.
I think some time ago, John Kearney approached the club. Brilliant guy John Kearney is. The man who turned down the role of James Bond, famously. But a great actor, a great poet, a great author. And he approached Celtic to say that there should be a lasting monument to Jimmy McGrory up at Celtic Park. And that was many, many years ago. And it's never happened. And I think the more of these monuments, the better. I mean, I know that we've got the fantastic Bobby Lennox statue at Saltcoats. And, you know, the more the better. I think there should be a Lisbon Lions statue for every one of the Lions. And it would be great. Yeah, it would be great to have them at Celtic Park. But it's also important to remember where they're from. And I know that there's a Billy McNeil commemorative committee set up to do the honours in Bells Hill. We've recently heard from the Willie Mealy committee. So I think that's important, Declan, and it's all part of the history, and we've got to continue to spread that from generation to generation. When you go up to Celtic Park, how important is it just to even look at these statues and remember what these great men did for the club?
It's massive. It's massive for players, especially coming in the door, you know, that don't maybe have a great knowledge of the club to point to these guys and explain to them what they achieved at Celtic, you know, and their legacy. Of course, Brother Wilfred founding the club, Big Billy, Jimmy and Jock being part of that side that won the European Cup. Jimmy voted greatest ever player, Billy greatest ever captain, and of course, Jock Steen, to many people, greatest ever manager. So these guys' legacy should be there forevermore. And as you say, in other places where these people are originally from, they should be honoured. I mean, the Billy McNeil committee aren't just there for the quickness of a statue, they're going to make that a lasting legacy to help in the local community, which is really delivering on a promise of a lasting legacy in honour of Billy, which I think could be the case for a lot of the guys, because what they achieved didn't just change football, but changed society and changed culture and their place should be forevermore.
Should never be forgotten. It's always something to aspire to, you know, when you see a statue of a man who, or a sports person who originated from, you know, maybe humble beginnings, Declan. If I go back to some of the areas in Fife that I spent my formative years in, and if you look at High Valleyfield, for example, and there is a war, a pit disaster monument in High Valleyfield. And I think that, you know, the fact that a young man came from that village, swapped the pit boots for football boots, and represented his country, played in a European Cup final, was Scotland's player of the year. If there was something there to remember the great George Connolly by, it's something for generations to aspire to, because they look around their environment and they might think that there's no hope for them, there's no escape. And then you look at this shining beacon of a statue of someone who was able to trailblaze all over Europe as one of the most talented footballers the country's ever produced. So it's so, so important. I mean, I'm just thinking, though, if you had a statue of Bertie, what would the pose be? Would it be when he's got his top off and he's got the bowler hat and all that? Maybe.
The Leeds United pose?
Yeah.
Maybe the Clyde pose when he's sitting in the ball? I don't really know. I mean, there's that many. Are the old famous Partick Thistle pose with a cigar hanging out the mouth?
But aye.
I don't know. We'd probably need to get that opinion off Bertie, what he prefers. Maybe just him on the ball on his way, as he did so often for Celtic in the middle of the park with Bobby Murdoch.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, what's Bertie's thoughts then about the fact that your club's named after him? Has he been able to join you? I know that I've seen you on social media. I've seen Bertie wearing the T-shirts and that kind of thing.
Yeah, as I said, after we played St Johnston, the 7-0 game, opening game of the season last year, he came up to the pub and, I mean, he stood for 2 hours and took a photograph. I think everybody in that pub took a photograph of him. Wasn't in any rush to get away. And I think he's just really humbled and delighted that, you know, that there's that legacy there for him and Maryhill, that there's 50 guys cutting about with his T-shirt on. Did the T-shirts and have been sent to the Republic of Ireland. They've been sent to England. So it's not just in Maryhill. The T-shirts getting sported Belfast as well. So I think he just really likes the idea that, you know, there's that connection there between Bertie and Maryhill, and it's been celebrated, long overdue.
As it should. Talk to us then about the connection between Celtic and Maryhill, Declan.
There's a massive connection, which I never really noticed until recently, especially between the junior clubs. And you're talking real Celtic legends here. So Maryhill Juniors is just about 10 minutes up the road from where our bus leaves from. And that is where Celtic used to fan players out to quite a lot. So Tommy Burns, Pat McCluskey, Danny McGrain, Paul Wilson, you know, four, you know, key players for Celtic's history, all played for Maryhill Juniors. And before that was the Maryhill Harp, which is where Bertie signed from. Donkey Mackay, Willie Miller, the goalkeeper, Frank Caffey, Jimmy Quinn Jr. and Peter Scarfe played for Maryhill Hibernian. So there is a plethora of Celtic legends to have played junior football in Maryhill and then made the step from there to Celtic Park, or have been loaned out to Maryhill to kind of get toughened up before they go into the first team, being the example with Tommy Burns and Danny McGrain.
And it done them no harm, Declan. We were talking earlier today about the youth development and that bridge between youth development football and first team football. Back in the day, of course, you had the reserve league, but you also had this tradition of farming players out, and some of the names you've mentioned there, there are many others who spent time with Cumbernauld United, for example, in the case of Kenny Dalglish. And I think what we were trying to get to the bottom of is whether or not the lack of the reserve league is stifling a lot of young players' development, Declan. What's your thoughts on that? We've got a whole host of young guys getting freed every single year out of Celtic Park, and a huge percentage of them are lost to the game. Loads and loads of players go on to have careers elsewhere. But a lot of that is down to the fact that there's a point, maybe at the age of 18, where, you know, an 18-year-old needs to start playing against what you would describe as first-team players, players with that experience coming back from injury, maybe out of favour. And it really is something that we've missed in the Scottish game. Obviously, the news that Aaron Hickey is maybe on his way to Bayern Munich broke yesterday or today. And a lot of the country's youngsters are fleeing the nest and going elsewhere. Do you think it would be an idea either to get the Colts teams in as Celtic wanted, or to get a reserve league back? Because at the moment, a lot of the time, these young guys are lost to the game.
I think a reserve league is the way to go. I used to certainly enjoy, when my dad used to take me along to watch reserve football, because guys that were maybe coming back to an injury or just weren't getting a game were given that opportunity. It meant they were playing constantly. To play at the level you have to play at Celtic, you need constant football. And there's guys in our team that just don't get that, and they need it. Guys that, especially like the two January signings, Smalley Asoro and Patrick Klamala, they sat there for so long not getting that constant football, mm-hmm. which isn't good. Players need to play football. But touching on what you were saying about lost generation, the situation we're in just now, in my opinion, I don't think the SFA's put enough pressure on the Scottish Government to get youth football back up and running, and we're going to lose a lot of people if they don't. But the attitude in Scotland towards youth football, to me, is very poor. The amount of times growing up, you notice the no ball game signs, go to pitches and they're padlocked up. If you want to play in that pitch, it's 60 quid for you and your pals. That isn't going to encourage any kids to come through and play the game. So, you know, just now I'm worried for youth football especially. But I think a reserve league would certainly be something. I mean, as well as that, it could make clubs money. I mean, we know the struggles that Scottish teams have. For a team like Hamilton to maybe be playing a kind of reserve team, because Hamilton, a great club, a great academy that players seem to break through in. For them to be playing against, you know, a chain Celtic team that would maybe featured guys like Soro and Klamala that won't be getting into the first team too much, it's good for the league, it's good for the opposition, it's good for youth football in Scotland to come through, and hasn't did any other generation any harm. I mean, you're booting a quality seat gang. I'm sure a lot of the guys would say that the lessons they learned from playing against the Lions and breaking into that team moulded them as footballers. And guys like Kenny Dalglish, Danny McGrain, George Conley certainly benefited from that, so I don't see why not. But at this current point in time, I'm worried for youth football.
Yeah, there are concerns with that, Declan. The other side of it is, look at a player like Tommy Rogic. Now, if he's not playing in the first team, as he currently isn't, and it could be due to injury, it could be he's out of favour, there could be a period, after a long period of time, when a player like Rogic or Soro, who you've mentioned, and Klamala previously, Sved's another example, where they just don't play any games. You know, once you're into the week-to-week you know, process and routine of the season, then it's not as though Celtic can set up loads of friendly or bounce matches to make sure that these squad players are getting enough games. It's then difficult to get them bedded into the side. They might not be prepared physically. So I'm a bit concerned also for the likes of, say, I think Rogic's a good example at the moment. He's not played a lot of football over the last 18 months.
No, he's not. And going back to the game against Kilmarnock, when we're talking about creativity coming on, he was a guy that you're screaming out for him, or Lee Griffiths, and he just seems to be completely off the radar just now, which is a shame, because he came up with so many big moments for Celtic and you would like to see him featured more, but it's just, where is he, is a question.
I know, and that's someone who, you know, a couple of years back was an asset. You know, if you had sold him, he would have been a big asset for any club, and Celtic would have been able to profit. But season on season, the less you play, Declan, the actual value is going to plummet, to the point where, you know, a guy who, you know, probably would have gone for about 10 million quid a year or two ago, it's difficult to know where his future lies. And it always frustrates me, because someone like Rogic has provided some amazing moments for Celtic fans in the not too distant past. And it's really frustrating when they just disappear. They're out of favour. But the only way that they can prove themselves is on a training pitch. Yeah. Back in the day, you could have gone out and ran the show or scored the hat-trick for the reserves. The famous story in Andy Lynch's book when he scores four goals against Rangers, when he's nursing a sore head, it's got to be said. But he puts himself back into the plans by, you know, bringing himself to the attention and getting the scouting reports from the reserve team manager. It's something I hope will change. But again, we've been plummeted into the coronavirus issue of finance. So beforehand, clubs were saying they couldn't come up with the money to run a reserve team. Celtic could, but they were at the mercy of all these other clubs, because there wasn't a league to play in. So that's a frustration, and one that we'll return to, I'm pretty sure. Now, with every CSC, I think back to some of the characters in my old bus, Declan, and telling you tales that you certainly couldn't repeat on this podcast. Who are the characters in your Celtic Supporters Club?
When you go into the pub, there's a kind of group of older gentlemen that stand up.
But older to you, though, Declan, but could be me. What age are we talking about?
70s, 80s. Oh, you know, right, these really are guys, old. These are well-seasoned guys. And when you're a wee guy, it's a corner you don't approach, you know, because that's where the real man talk happens up there. But as I've got older, obviously they've looked after me as I've grown up and stuff, quite here and that. And it's guys like Abe, Ben Kearney, Peter, just really nice older guys that have been there, seen and done it. And the guy who also want to give a mention is Jackie Henderson, who ran the Garscree Emerald bus before. Jackie's no longer with us, but again was a character that my dad had a lot of time for, and Robert Bond too. So there was a kind of, it's a corner of the older guys. There was a big team of them. They are not as heavy-handed now, unfortunately, as life goes on. But they're the characters. The other character on our bus is Doogie. If you go to away games, you will probably see me with a character that looks quite like Billy Connolly.
Oh, yeah.
And that is wee Doogie. He is mental. He comes from Balfron. He is Celtic daft. First game was the 69 Cup final for the Leeds Rangers. Mm-hmm. He went to Milan the year after that as a 16-year-old. You can hear him from one stand to the other if you're at an away game due to his loud voice and constant moaning. But he's brilliant. He's probably one of the biggest characters in our bus. But there's other lads in the bus that, you know, good laugh and stuff. It's myself, my dad, Doogie and Jerry that run the bus. But probably if you're going to put a character that goes constantly in the bus, it's wee Doogie, just for his craziness, his wacky Doc Martin boots, his jeans, his old Celtic tops that he's wearing. Because in the jeans Paul has, he gets these mad patches with the stitching, HH on it and all that, keep the faith. Big number 10s and 88s, it's mental. Peering in a pair of purple Doc Martin boots and you're looking and you're thinking, what's going on here? But you get at the football, oh, they're the big one. And he's, Doogie's weirder than me, so he's like 5'6" or something. He doesn't look anything like Billy Connolly, but due to the long grey hair, there's been a few people. I managed to get €10 off a guy in Munich for a photo of him. I said, it's Billy Connolly. I said, he's just flew in for the game. Oh, big one. 40, €10. Thanks very much.
You're a bad man. So,
not at all. That guy should just get an appointment at Specsavers instead of fighting a guy at 5'6".
You did bump into Billy Connolly when you came through to Stirling, didn't
I
you?
I did.
When we used to record through in Stirling, yeah, for a Celtic State of Mind. Well, where were you? Pretty Green?
I was Pretty Green.
Yeah.
Liam Gallagher's shop. It was a Saturday afternoon, you know, and I think it was here recording. But we get chatting because I've got a kind of wee family link with Billy Connolly, and that my great-grandfather's brother was Billy's dad's best man. So I was able to tell him that, and he knew my surname, which was great. I was kind of looking at him going, what? It was like that, yep, right away, McConville, I said, uh-huh. And just really nice guy, gave me a good bit of time in his day, got a photograph, spoke a wee bit about Celtic, and I let him go in Brown's Liam Gallagher's fine selection of clobber.
Brilliant, but you failed to bring him along to the studio for a wee interview. You know?
I did, unfortunately.
You failed your assignment.
I think the big game was a wee bit busy, but if he's listening in, or Pamela's maybe listening in, he's always welcome to dial in from Florida.
Yeah, he is always welcome, that's for sure. Listen, talk to me about some of the highlights. Colin Watt is a regular contributor on A Celtic State of Mind, and he never shuts up about going to watch Celtic against Lazio away from home. So what kind of highlights have you had following Celtic with the Bertie Auld?
At this current point in time, due to the way the ticket structures worked, we're only running home games, but I see a lot of the guys at away games. So the big highlights for me would be probably the derby games and cup finals, especially the treble cup final, because that was the first real season we'd run a bus. The manager had walked out on us. We have that pressure of going to Tynecastle. All eyes are on us, and we get to the cup final, win the league. You know, treble time. Can we do it? Go to Hampden. And it was just brilliant. See, when you're sitting at the front of the bus.
We've got a message coming in for Colin Watt, Declan.
Oh,
hold that thought. excuse yourself, Mr. Dykes. Don't get too jealous about missing Lazio away.
Well, I was there too. So
it's good. It's good that he's tuning in. It's good that he's tuning in, Declan.
Yep. So sitting at the front of the bus, you see all the happy faces coming on after a cup final, and you get a real good kick out of that. But when we came back, Garscoe Broad, as you know, before you got to Fir Hill, the whole pub came out in the street and we did a big massive huddle. The traffic just stopped and we were all jumping about, giving it let's all do the huddle. So that was probably the highlight for that. But on away games, I saw a lot of folk in Lazio, not to take Colin's thunder, but that was just a brilliant night to see a lot of folk that go home and away faithfully, especially a lot of folk that go to European games and see us get some doings. To go to the capital, I actually got quite a good story about that day. My friend that I was with, I won't name her, she knows who she is, lost her ticket in a taxi going to the park. So we were to get a bus from the park to the stadium. So we leave the hotel, get in the taxi, get to this park, and she goes, I think I've lost my ticket. And I goes, what? And there was a big, there was a kind of worry about the tickets because you had your name and date of birth written on it. So if you didn't have a ticket with your name and date of birth written on it, you were not getting in at the Stadio Olimpico. So she's, you know, distraught, not getting to the game. I'm thinking, I'm not even going to get to this game now. I'm going to need to stay with her. My dad's like, calm down, it's all right. So we're trying to phone up the taxi number. You know, I don't really speak a great deal of Italian. I can say hello and I can order a beer. And they're just getting blah, 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 blah. I was like, oh, no. So we jumped in a taxi, go back to the hotel, says the guy in the hotel, what's happened? He can speak really good English. Phones the taxi up because we had the wee kind of receipt of the number. And the taxi driver still had the ticket. And I thought, oh, thank God. You know, we were in Rome, so the Holy Father was really looking down on us that day. And he drove back across Rome. It took about 40 minutes, longest 40 minutes of my life. This wee guy appeared, kind of wee taxi driver, bonnet on, pair of sunglasses. I have ticket for you. I've given him a big cuddle. I said, there's €40, mate. Thanks very much. And that was us on our way to the game. So that probably made the experience even better because I actually thought, I was in Rome and thought, I'm not going to this game of football here.
So listen, I've no hope Declan, I've not got. You're a gentleman. Trouble. You're a gentleman as well because, I mean, you weren't going to go to the game.
No, I was going to leave my best pal.
Well done. Well done, son. Now, when you look at the situation you've just described there when Neil Lennon comes in, he comes in because, obviously, the manager walked out on us. He walked out on us and there was a great disappointment around about that time, but what could have happened is Celtic could have capitulated. It would have been, I'm not saying it would have been easy for that to happen, but, you know, human behaviour, human nature, Declan, we could have crumbled under that kind of pressure and in that scenario. But we didn't, and I think Celtic fans certainly give Neil Lennon credit for the way that he conducted himself, the way that he handled that situation. Kevin Graham called it, you know, it was a masterclass in crisis management, and it was. And he stayed really calm. You know, when a lot of other people around about him, fans included, could have lost their heads a bit. And he was able to get us over the line. Now, in different, completely different circumstances, all these months later, what we're talking, 18 months later now, Declan, and we're thrown into another scenario, which is a very difficult situation to be in, with the ball and golly issue. So that results this evening in us approaching our first European game, having missed two competitive games of football. So we're going into this a wee bit colder than we should be. Do you have enough faith in the likes of Neil Lennon for what he's done previously, that he'll be able to get us through this? And we can look back, hopefully having won 10 in a row, and say, you know, he's done it again.
I've got massive faith in Neil Lennon as a person and as a football manager. Anybody that's met Neil or knows Neil knows he's just a fantastic guy. And as you said, a masterclass in crisis management, yeah. And he seems to work well in the face of adversity because his whole football career at Celtic has had some horrific instances, you know, of the bullets getting sent to him, being attacked at Tynecastle, and then, obviously that's nothing I mean, the size of that is ridiculous, but compared to what he came into, it was just different level, because that should not be happening to anybody in a game of football. But he does so well under pressure, and when anybody was asking the question, what was he going to do with the whole Boring Goldie incident, he's kept a lid on it, he's kept it can, I'm sure he's kept it well indoors with the players and told them their responsibilities again, and will have boosted morale well. In the car crash interview yesterday, Scott Brown does say that Neil did fine, you know, morale-wise in the dressing room. So, yeah, I've got every faith in him to get us over the line this season, because he knows what it is to be a Celtic manager and he knows what it is to win. He is a winner. And to me, I wouldn't have anybody else in our dugout tonight or going for the 10 than Neil.
Declan, we will be back. We'll be back at 7:15 this evening for our coverage, our match day coverage of tonight's European encounter. It's a win or bust game for us tonight. We'll talk all about the team announcement, which will be with us by then. We'll be looking at predictions, and all the way through the game, we'll be analysing and discussing the action as it happens, along with all the viewers on YouTube, Twitter and Facebook. Please subscribe to us on YouTube, because we are producing multi-content on a daily basis on that channel and elsewhere. All that's left for me to say at the moment, Declan, is thank you once again for joining me on A Celtic State of Mind.
Pleasure, Paul. Thank you.